among the entire Muslim world when it comes to Islam. The first school of thought, they believe no being is ma'soom except Allah. Doesn't matter. Prophet, Imam, any person, human being, it's impossible to be ma'soom. And they call them in fiqh or in aqa'id, they call them al-hashawiyin. The group of Muslims, that's what they do. They say the ma'soom is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But no human being, doesn't matter how good they can be, they cannot be ma'soom. Because they can have some kind of influence of shaitan, if not physically, at least in mind. How can they be ma'soom? Right? And there are some examples from the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks in Surah Yusuf about Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, where Allah clearly said, وَلَكَدْ هَمَّتْ بِهِ وَهَمَّ بِهَا لَوْلَا عَرَّى بُرْهَانَ رَبِّهِ. So this ayah is one of the clear evidence. Hamma bihi, hamma in Arabic is like he had something in his heart. What is it? We don't know. But that's what the Quran says, right? Towards her as she does. It's okay, he's a ma'soom, but he has something at least in the mind level. I mean, no, he didn't do it physically, but at least something in his mind. How can he be ma'soom? So they have this group. They do not believe that any human being can be ma'soom. That's group one. Group number two, among the Muslims. They said, we believe there is an isma. A prophet can be ma'soom. And this is only prophet, not imams. They say only the prophet can be ma'soom. But even that isma, that infallibility is partially, not fully. Which means they are ma'soom when they receive revelation from Allah. And two, when they deliver the message of Allah, they're ma'soom in this. But in other things, they are like anybody else. That is the second school of thought. And they also believe that those prophets who are ma'soom, their isma start from where? From the time they are declared to be prophet. But before that, they can do anything else like anybody else. They can drink alcohol, they can steal, they can cheat, they can kill, they can do anything. And they have all of these evidences, or they also have some ayahs in the Quran. They back these sayings up to. For example, you go to the Quran, they say in Surah Al-Duha about the Prophet, Allah said, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. He finds you, dal means what? Misguided. Rasulullah was misguided, then Allah pulled him back and guided him. That's one of them. Another ayah in the Quran, they say, Allah says about Musa alayhi salam, when he killed that person from the Qibtis, and he came back later on, Pharaoh asked him, he said, "Ya Musa, you remember? Fa'alta fa'alta kallati fa'alt. Remember when you did what you did? Killing innocent people? Right?" Then Musa answered, he said, "Fa'altuha idhan wa ana min ad-dhalin. I did what I did when I was among dhalin." Balin, according to that tafsir, it means I was misguided. So before Allah asked him to go and start preaching, they are like any other human being. They can kill wrong people, they can commit sin, they can lie. But from the moment Allah chose them to be prophet, at that moment they become ma'soom in only when Allah sent them the message. And when they are to deliver the message of Allah. And from here, you can understand the concept of the history when people challenge the Prophet. In certain things, when they challenge the Prophet, أَهَذَا مِنْكَ أَوْ مِنْ اللَّهِ, is it from you or from Allah? Right? Because they have the concept that if it's from Allah, then we cannot challenge. But if it's from you, we can challenge you. That's where the concept comes from, right? Now, that is the second school of thought. So they believe that the Prophets, they are infallible. From where? From the moment Allah assigned them to be messengers. But not before that. And even at the time they are messengers and prophets, they are only infallible in receiving the message and delivering. That's it. But the other part of their life is normal than anybody else. That's group number two. Group number three, which are the Shia, the Ithna Ashari. They said, we agree with the second group, but even more. Right? We agree on them. That every prophet is ma'soom. That part we agree, right? And not only we agreed their prophet, we also take it another step forward, which is every imam of Ahlul Bayt is also masoom. Which the second group, they don't go that far. Right? The third group, they say, we go that far to believe that every imam of Ahlul Bayt, they're all also masoom. That's one. And number two, they say, we even take it another step, which is, and the second group, they said, the prophet, their isma start from the time they become prophet. They say, no, for us, they are masoom from the birth. The moment they arrive in this world, they're masoom. What are they declared their prophethood from that moment, like Prophet Isa alayhi salam, or they declare later after 40 years like our prophet? Doesn't matter. They still masoom. Meaning they are considered infallible from the childhood to the birth, to the death. Not only that, they say we also believe, right, that not only they are masoom in receiving and delivery, they are masoom in every single aspect of their life. Every single aspect, they are masoom. That is the Shia school of thought. Now, when you come to all these three school of thought, the first group, which is the Ashawids, they are in peace of mind because they don't have to answer any questions. Because they agree, no masoom. That's it. They go to bed, peace of mind. Nobody can question them why this is in the Quran, because I don't believe anybody's masoom. Now, when you come to the second group, they say, okay, we believe that they are masoom and certain level, but they are not in others. They can answer some questions, but not more. But the Shia have to answer questions more than anyone else. Because their belief is more vast and wider than the other school of thought. Because they believe more than anybody else. Because they not only they believe in the Asma that all the prophets are masoom, they also believe and that even imams also are masoom. So how can they justify, how can they prove this from the Quran and also intellect-wise as well? So this is one of the big topics. Now, if the Shia school of thought, they believe that every prophet and every imam is masoom, then how do we justify what Adam did? Which Allah clearly stated in the Quran, in the ayah where Allah said, فَعَسَىٰ آدَمَ رَبُّهُ فَغَوَىٰ. Adam did disobey his Lord. How can they be masoom? When the Nas al-Quran said, Asa, he disobeyed. Right? Another ayah about Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَكَدْ أَهِئْنَا إِلَىٰ Adam. We gave a commitment to Adam. Right? وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ أَزْمًا. But we didn't find him to keep that promise. Promise not to sin, but he did commit sin. So how can we justify this? Not only this about Adam alayhi salam, so many other prophets as well, like Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, like Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, there's so many sin about them. Our Prophet himself also is included also, because in Surah Al-Fatah, Allah said, لِيَغْفِرَ لَقَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ. The word ذَنْبِك means sin. Allah said, to forgive your previous sin, وَمَا تَأَخَّرُ, and the coming sin. How can you justify that the Prophet is masoom when Allah is saying here for the past sin and the coming sin? How do you justify about Prophet Yunus alayhi salam when Allah clearly became mad at him and made him to be swallowed by the whale? And Allah said, لَوْلَا أَنْ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ. Had he not been among those who glorified, he would have stayed there. Allah clearly is not happy with him. So that is, how can that be asma? How can he be masoom? This is all questions the Shia school have to answer. That is why I say this topic itself is a vast. And every prophet that you see, they have questions. Why did they do this? And you come to Prophet Adam, Prophet Musa alayhi salam, also we mentioned, he killed another innocent person. Which Quran says, فَعَلْتُهَا إِذَا مُعَنَا مِنَ الضَّالِينَ. Now, what does the mean of ضَالِين means? When the Quran says about the prophet, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. You were misguided, and then, so if he was misguided, well, that means he's going to do the wrong thing too. That takes the asma from him. So how do we justify this as the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam? There is no time to talk about this in very detail, but I would just give one answer from the 2 points. One is about Quranic point of view, and two, logic point. This Quran and the logic. We have so many hadith about also proving the Prophet are masoom, and so as the ayahs of the Quran. But just for the sake of the time,
I will just make sure that we just stick to this and then move to the second question and the third. Now, the first answer, when we say that we believe that all the prophets are ma'soom, our proof from the Quran, one of them is called Al-Ayah Al-Quraniyah, the Ayah of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in one of the ayahs, they said, our scholars, they divided what we call At-Ta'ah into two categories, which means obedience. There are two kinds of obedience in the Quran. One is called At-Ta'atul Muqayyada. At-Ta'ah means obedience, but limited obedience. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He tells us, all of us, He said, I ordered all of you to obey certain people, but obey them, their obedience is limited. Who are those people? Our parents. Our parents in the Quran, in Surah Luqman, Allah stated, He says, we are ordered by Him, Allah, to obey them and be kind and nice to them. But provided they do not ask us to do, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ. When they force or urge you to disobey Allah in things that you don't have knowledge of, Allah says, فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. Do not obey them. وَلَكِنْ صَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا. But obey them in other things. So here Allah tells us, obey them, but the obedience as well is limited. You are to obey them in everything except when they urge you or ask you to do haram, then the limit comes in there. That is called At-Ta'ah Al-Muqayyadah, means obedience with limitation. That is one. The second one is called obedience without limitation. Obedience with no limitation. Where? In Surah An-Nisa. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul. وَأُولُوا الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Allah said, oh, those of you who believe, obey ta'a Allah, obey Allah. Okay, to obey Allah, was there, is there any condition that's limited or not? They said, no, there's not any condition. Completely, fully, absolute obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one. The second one, وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ, and obey the messengers. Now, is there any limitation? No. Then the third one, وَأُولُوا الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, and them also the leaders of your affairs, which in the Ahlul Bayt school of thought, it means those are the Ahlul Bayt.
Allah.
Here when you come, the ayah did not limit for Allah, or the Prophet, or the Ahlul Bayt. Now, if Allah was to make mistake, shouldn't He put limitation like the parents? Wow. Yes, but Allah didn't. So that means Allah is ma'asum. Now coming to the Prophet, Allah also said, wa ati'u ar-rasul. Any limitation? No. Why? Because the Prophet is ma'asum. Had he also come make mistake, Allah would have put limitation like mom and dad. When you come to Ulil Amr also, Allah didn't put limitation. Because all these three, Allah made sure that Allah did not put any limit on them. He gave them full and absolute obedience because they are ma'asum. So from that ayah, our scholars, we prove that our imams and the Prophet, they're all ma'asum. Because if they are not, Allah would have put the limitation like that. Now, that is a proof one. Proof number two, aql wise. We say, look, when you look in this world that we live in, every human being, in Islam to speak, every human being has two needs. One is called haja badaniya, needs of the body. You need to eat, you need to drink, you need to do things to keep this body alive. That is one part of the need of a human being. Then there is another side of the need, which is called al-haja ruhiya, spiritual need. Now, for a human being to need this body, for to take care of this body, Allah created what we call food. And part of that food is called fruit. Right? Now, some of the fruit we eat, they come from seeds. Now when you take that seed, let's say you take the seed of orange with its size and you plant them, right? You put them on the ground, you put water, you cover it. When it grows, by any chance you ever tried and see, you plant the seed of orange and it turns watermelon? Anyone experience that? No? Now let's try another thing. They said, I have the seed of apple. I plant it, then anybody, by any chance, that this seed become banana. When I bought it, it was the seed of apple. But when I planted, it's now banana. Have you ever seen that? No. Why? Because that seed, Allah made it ma'soom for you to obtain the food that you need for your body. If the food of the body is infallible, then the food of spirit is more needed to be ma'soom. There are two needs here. One is for the body, right? Now the body was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made. The seed that you put in your mouth is ma'soom. Not only just the fruit itself, even the size wise doesn't get mistaken. When you look at you take any seed, when you plant it, when they grow, they give you the same size. No mistake whatsoever. Now, that is just the fruit. There is no alcohol, there is nothing, but it was given the guidance that it doesn't make a mistake. So you can get the food and the fruit to take care of your body. Now the need of the soul is more important. And that food also should be ma'asoo. And the food of the heart is what? Is Ahlul Bayt alayhi wassalam and the Prophet. That is one of the reasons we said Ahlul Bayt are ma'asoo. Now, if this is clear, let's go to the next one. And that is okay about Adam alayhi wassalam. What was the sin that Adam committed that Allah talks about? Now here, let me tell you, in Islam in general, there are three kinds of sins. We have three different kinds of sin. The first sin is called al-dhanbul mutlaq, which means absolute sin. A sin is absolute sin. Example, lying. Example, stealing. Example, associating Allah with something. Example, oppression. All of these sins is called al-dhanbul mutlaq. These are the sins that Allah promised punishment in the Quran. That's called al-dhanbul mutlaq. That's one. The second one is called al-dhanbul nisbi. Al-dhanbul nisbi means sin compared to certain things, but it's not sin by itself. I'll give you an example. Now, when we pray, as a normal people, when we pray, as among ourselves, we are urged to pray with what we call in fiqh hudur al-qalb. Put your heart being there, your mind should be in the salah. But if you do pray and your heart is not there, your salat is batil or sahih or correct? It's correct. Provided that you didn't do any mistake, you prayed, you did everything correct, but your mind and your heart was not there, your salat is still considered? Now the same salat, if it is done by the Prophet, is it accepted? No. Why? It's the same salat, right? The Prophet comes and he performed the prayer, but his mind and heart is not in there, like you and I. Allah said, that salat I'm not accepting. Why? Because I expect from you more than that. This is called al-dhanbun nisbi. Meaning, if you compare that sin, right, that action, if it's done by you and me, Allah said, no problem, you come in, I'll take it because of that your level. But if the Prophet prayed the same prayer, Allah said, no, I reject that prayer. Why? Because the expectation from Allah for that person is higher than one. That's called dhanbun nisbi. And some scholars, they call it tarkul awla. And among ourselves, it's the same thing. We have this, the same thing. Now, you go among the general public. Right? Among general public. Sometimes your neighbors, your friends, right, who know that you're Muslim, you're practicing, certain times you do something, they say, oh, what are you doing? I thought you're Muslim. What does it mean? Meaning, I expect more from you than what you're doing. But other people can do the same thing. He would not comment about it. They'll say, okay. But for you as a Muslim, what hijab or practicing, they're like, why are you doing this? You're not supposed to do this, but others will do it, and there's no question about it. I'll give you an example. Now, wearing t-shirt, is that haram or it's okay? It's okay. Nobody says haram. A man, see, all right, they can wear t-shirt, they can wear jeans. But if you have, let's say, one great scholar, Ayatollah Sayyid Sistani, comes with t-shirt and sweatpants, how would you react? Right? He comes here with the sweatpants, huh? Assalamu alaikum. The first answer, we are not going to even have the mind to say, wa alaikum, a'uzu billah. Say, yeah, what this one? Okay, you walk out, how many people wear sweatpants? Millions, right? How many people wear t-shirt?
Millions.
Do you get shocked? No. But what is it said? No. But why is it Sistani shocking? Because you hold him in a high level. So if it is that others can do, for him you think he shouldn't do that. That is called adhanbun nisbi, what we call tarkul awla. That is the second sin. Now the third one is called al-adhanbul irshadi. Al-irshadi means what?
It's an advice.
That in Islam, there are certain things Islam tells you don't or do, but it's all about advice from Allah to the same. Example, like when the doctor tells a person, do not eat too much sweet. For example. Or do not take more than this dose of this medicine. For example. Now this doctor, if he tells you do not eat sweet or do not take more of this medication, and you do take the medication, is he going to call you to the court and take you to the jail because you took more medication?
No.
He tells you don't, right? He tells, don't take this medication. It's not good for you. But if you do take it, the doctor cannot put you in the prison just because you did take more medication. No, all he can do is what? To decide that you disobey. But he does not put you anywhere because his order was nothing but advice. Now, if we understand all these three sins, one is called Adhanbul Mutlaq, the second one is called Adhanbul Nisbi, and the third one is called Adhanbul Irshadi. Which one of these three Adam did come? The first one, Adhanbul Mutlaq? Of course not. The Prophet, is haram upon them to commit this, what we call Adhanbul Mutlaq. It's haram, they cannot do that. That's where the Isma comes in. Now the second one is called Adhanbul Nisbi, which is, it's an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as to don't do this, right? However, if you do it, we will hold you accountable. That's what Adam did. It's called tark al-awla, which is two things. One is the best and one is good, right? Now the Prophet, according to the Allah standard, Allah is expecting him to come to be, to always choose the best. But if he chooses the good, he still considers what? For his level, it's the same. That is one of this ayah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fa'asa Adam rabbahu faghawa. Adam did disobey Allah, not disobedient as the dhanbul mutlaq. It was disobedient that we talk about tark al awla. Means two things that is better not to, but he chose to do them. That is the answer to Adam alayhi salam in here. So Adam alayhi salam, what he did was nothing but what? Is just to do something that is chose between good and the best. One. Now we said, okay, the question is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly stated, la taqrab hadhihi shajar. Do not go closer to this sin, to this tree. Now first of all, we have to understand that our scholars, they said, that Adam alayhi salam, one of the reasons we say he did not commit sin, because that order that Allah gave was not in this world. It was in where? In heaven. The word that Allah told him, لا تقرب هذه الشجرة. If the same thing was to say on this earth, it should have been the same thing as haram. That ذنب المطلق. But when Allah told him, don't eat the tree, it was in the Jannah. And in Jannah, there is no rules like the rules of the earth. So what Adam did, still is not considered sin. But in his level, yes, Allah holds him accountable because it's better for him not to, but it's not as sin as we think. That is the first question
that we answered about Adam alayhi salam and the Aliga. Now the second question about Iblis as Shaitan.
Why would Allah create him?
Well, Allah says, no. Not only he will misguide Adam and Hawa, he will also misguide the millions and billions of people even after Adam. Why would Allah create him? The answer is this. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create Iblis. There's a difference between Allah created him to be Iblis and Allah created him something and he chose to be something else. Well, Allah first created Iblis. You know, by the way, his name was not Shaitan when he was first created. His name was Iblis. When Allah created him to begin with, Allah created him like any one of us. There are two potential in him. One is the potential of being good and the potential of being bad. That Allah said about us. He said, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every human being, Allah put these two potential. The potential of good and bad. Now it is you and me, which one you would like to develop inside yourself. Sometimes I want to develop the evil. Then I can go to the level of Shaitan. And Allah called the people, those people also Shayateen. Shayateen al-Ins wal Jinn. If I develop that evil inside me, I can go as higher to get to the level of Shaitan. If I decided to develop the good part also, I can go higher to the level of the Prophet. Like one of the examples. Salman al-Farisi, where the Prophet says, Salmanun minna. Salman was not Arab to begin with. Salman was not among Ahlul Bayt, but his faith and his action that he was able to develop the good, he was able to reach to that level where even some of the spouses of the Prophet would not get to that level. When Ayat al-Tahir was revealed, a lot of the spouses of the Prophet came. You want to be part? The Prophet said, no. Salman didn't even ask for it, but the Prophet said, Ya Salman, anta minna Ahlul Bayt. You are part of Ahlul Bayt. But it's part because not by blood, by action. That is, a person, these two powers that Allah put in us, the power of evil and the power of good, a person is the one who is responsible. If I develop this one, the good, I can raise to the level of angels. If I develop this, the evil, I can also raise to the level of Shaitan. And that is what Iblis did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him that two potential. He can be good, he can be bad. But he chose to do good. And that is why later on his name was changed to be Shaitan. And this word Shaitan is a word that is used for every being, whether it's human or jinn, who has gotten himself to be always doing evil. We call him Shaitan. That's why it's called Shaitan. Otherwise, his name was Iblis, where it was completely different. But because this Iblis has worked on this evil and got to the point where he always thinking evil. And our Imam Zayd al-Abidin, salamullah alayhi. In Mafatih al-Jinan, he has one dua about Iblis, where he talks about him, asking Allah for protection. And part of that dua, he says, Ya Rabbi innahu, min shaitan, la yaghfal in ghafal. He doesn't forget when we forget. Means what? Constantly he is in the mind of thinking of evil. Not only that, you're awake, even when you are asleep, shaitan doesn't leave you. That's why it's called Jihad al-Akbar. And some of the knowledge of the Prophet, fighting your soul is considered Jihad al-Akbar because there is no stop. And other jihad, when you fight your enemy outside, when you are sleeping, there is no more jihad. When you are praying, there is no jihad. When you are distracted, doing something else, you are not in jihad. But in this jihad, the nafs, no, constantly, even when you are asleep, the jihad still continues. Shaitan doesn't leave. This was called Jihad al-Akbar. So Shaitan and Iblis, he was able to develop that evil to that level, and that's why he became Shaitan. And that was by his choice, not Allah's choice. So Allah didn't create him to be shaitan. No, Allah created him as Iblis, but he chose to become Iblis, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Now question. Okay.
Now he chose to.
Okay. But Allah, you knew that he's gonna be like that. Why didn't you stop him?
If Allah knew that Iblis, he will be like this. Yes, he will choose this bad. And he will misguide other people. Yes, Allah, why didn't you stop him? I say the answer is, Allah did not stop him. Because if Allah is to stop him, then that is against his free will. Because Allah gave human and jinn free will to do things. Now, if Allah is not to let shaitan to be who he choose to be, then he become something else, not jinn. And jinn and humans supposed to have the free will to make their own choice by themselves. And that is one of the reasons why Allah didn't stop. That's one. Number two, Allah left shaitan to be who he was. First, he warned you and I about him, so to stay away on his farm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you went to the Quran from day one. Allah told us, Ya Bani Adam, Alam أَهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ. From the word, Allah told us, be careful about the shaitan. That's one. Number two, then Allah sent the Prophet to warn us about shaitan. That is two. Number three, Allah sent our imams also to prevent it from the shaitan. Then number four, Allah sent all the Quran that was revealed and the previous books. They are all as a reminder for us. Number five, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I will make the effort of shaitan and his plot. Allah said, I made it very weak. إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. His plot and his plot is all weak. Allah said, I weaken it. So you are more powerful than shaitan. But unfortunately, sometimes who let him in? We do. After all these warnings, Allah, Aql is there. Allah gave Aql to know the right and wrong. Then the Prophet, then the Imams, then the Quran, then plus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him weak. But still, sometimes, no. Maybe Shaitan will say, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when people blaming him, you got us all this trouble. Right? You know what Shaitan will say? Say, مَا كَانَ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ. I made a call, and you did for this. That's what he said. He doesn't say, no, I made, you know, he said, دَعَوْتُكُمْ. I called, and you responded to the call. Now, why are you blaming me? And sometimes, some people know, shaitan doesn't even make a call. You know? You know, sometimes you call somebody with your finger. Well, shaitan doesn't make a call. Sometimes, no. Some people, you look at them with the face, they say, oh, I mean you want me. Come on, I'm here. That's right. But if we are to stand and follow the teaching of the Prophet, and Ahlul Bayt, shaitan cannot misguide. And Allah will say in the Quran, where he said, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانٌ. My true servant, you have no power on them. If a person is to be the servant of Allah, you cannot get shaitan to misguide. In other words, let me tell you one thing. You know, in America here, one of the systems here in America is that when you buy a car, you have to put insurance on it. Isn't that the case? Okay. Now, if I refuse to say no, I don't have insurance. After they told me this insurance is going to protect you. So, and when you get an accident, what if you get hit by someone, we're going to go after them and get their everything back for you. If you hit someone, we will protect you and protect the other people also. Right? And then I said, no, I don't want the insurance. Now, if God forbid that I fall into accident, should I blame the company or I blame myself? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from day one, he tells you, I have insurance, come in to get covered, so shaitan cannot come on your way. The insurance is given by Allah. Allah said, Inna ibadi laysa laka alayhim sultan. My true servant, they covered. Shaitan cannot get to them. That's the insurance from Allah. But the moment I said, no, Ya Allah, I don't want that insurance. I want to be on my own. And then when I become a victim of shaitan, then Allah is not to blame. It's me who made that choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the agreement with us. That's why the Prophet, one time they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, can shaitan misguide you? You know what the Prophet said? He said, no. He said, my shaitan has surrendered. The shaitani aslama ala yadi. You surrender? Why? Because the Prophet has submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment we surrender completely to Allah, that's it, shaitan cannot come to us. Shaitan is very weak. So that's question number two. Question number three. How did he get into heaven? Well, shaitan knew from the beginning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want him there. Allah put only Adam and Hawa. How did he get in there? First answer is, you know, we mentioned in the previous discussion that the Jannah of Adam was on the earth. It was here on this earth, not in the heaven that Allah promised Mu'mineen. So Iblis was here anyway. So there was no any objection or any limitation that Shaitan can get in or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put that restriction on Shaitan. So Shaitan was not prohibited to get into that heaven. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that Adam alayhi salam was already protected by the faith and iman. So that is how he was able to get, because it was in this earth. That Jannah is a garden that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put Adam alayhi salam and Hawa to prepare them for the life to come. That's where the Jannah is. But the real Jannah that Allah promised Mu'mineen, Iblis cannot get in there. But the Jannah that Allah told Adam alayhi salam to enter and live there, that was the Jannah to dunya. Which one they asked Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. But that Jannah, as a kanat jannatun min jinan al-dunya. It was one of the heavens of this world. Tatla'u fiha al-shamsu wa taghrum. They say the sun comes out and sets as well. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq said the sun, that Jannah is here. Right? Because in Jannah of Akhirah, there is no sun. Jannah Yawm al-Qiyamah, inshaAllah, when we go to heaven, there is no sun in there. Allah said in the Quran, La yarawna fiha shamsan wala zamharira. Allah said in that Jannah, there is no sun. In other words, if you want to call it, the perfect weather, 70, 75 degrees, right? Everybody comes out with short and t-shirt, it's good, huh? That kind of weather, no sun to worry about. لا يرون فيها شمسا. But the Jannah that Adam was placed into, the Imam Ja'far said, تطلع فيها الشمس. The sun rises and sets as well, which indicates it's about this wall. And that wall, and Iblis also was part of it, and he could have gotten to that heaven without any hesitation. So that is the summary about these three questions that we discussed. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل
محمد. شيخ, I have a couple of questions about these three that you just answered.
Okay.
So one is that the Quran reference that you gave, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, is that the Rasul mentioned here is our Prophet only, or it's extended to all Prophets?
Right.
That's one question. And the second one is this three ways that you talked about the Zan. Is that another way to put it? Could be that you Allah gives tests to people according to their ability. And so the Prophet's tests are different than the tests that a non-believer or a common believer gets.
Right.
And that's why their Allah's ghadab or for them, from Allah's perspective, they are misguided or whatever you call, because the expectation of the test is different.
Right. So no, definitely. For the first question in regarding to Adam alayhi salam, and then the second question regarding the word prophet. Now, let me answer the second one, which is when the ayah comes in the Quran and says, Ar-Rasul.
Can you look at this? It comes with Alif wa Lam.
Yes.
Now, in Arabic, literally, we have different kinds of Lam, Alif wa Lam, which is definite. Mm-hmm. Now, there is one is called Al-Jins, Lam Al-Jins. Lam Al-Jins, which means what? You come to describe every kind of something. Like, for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Alhamdulillah. I want to say, Alhamdulillah. That Alif Allah is called Lamul Jins, meaning every kind of gratitude or thankful, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any language, any color, any shape belongs to Allah. That's why in English you see they say, all praise belongs to Allah, meaning every kind. So that love is called Lamul Jins, right? Now, and similar also, when they say Ar-Rasul, meaning any kind of prophet. Any kind, whether it's our prophet or the previous prophet, they all fall in the same. So that love is called Lamul Al-Jins, meaning every kind of prophet. That is question number one. Number two. Also, when we talk about the prophet and the test, definitely there is no doubt that in Islam, every human being is tested according to their ability. Every person. We are not tested on the same level. If us as a human being, we don't test people on the same level. A person in the first grade doesn't give in, we don't give them the test of somebody in the college. Right? Somebody's in the college, you don't give him the test of somebody in first grade because you look at this ability and then you test them accordingly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the same. That's why he says, La yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wus'aha. We do not put the responsibility on the any person unless they convert. That is why you see the Prophet and Imams, they have the toughest test than anybody else. Because their ability is much bigger and other than all. Yes.
Sheikh, yes. Related to this question, when you said that it's Lamul Jins, I have a confusion about it. So it's not Lamimar, it's not a particular Rasul, it's every Rasul. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely.
Why don't we have anything, for example, when it comes to Ulil Amr, why don't we have Lam over there?
Now, the word, because see, when you look at this, the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our scholars, they mentioned that there are two ati'u in the ayah. The first one says ati'u Allah, obey Allah, right? But the second one says wa ati'u ar-rasul. Then it didn't say wa ati'u ulul amr. It says wa ulul amr, meaning whatever ar-rasul has is the same ulul amr. Because when you look at the first ati'u Allah, obey Allah, then it says wa ati'u ar-rasul. Allah, the way we obey Allah is different than the way we obey the Prophet. We obey Allah because He is the ultimate goal. But when we obey the Rasul, we don't obey Him because He's the ultimate goal. We obey Him because He takes us to the ultimate goal. That's why Allah said, ati'u in kuntum tuhibbuna Allah, fattabi'uni. Follow me because I take you to Allah. Right? So when Allah said in the ayah, wa ati'u ar-rasul, then Allah didn't say, wa ulil amr minkum. Allah said, wa ati'u ulil amr. He said, wa ulil amr minkum. Because there is connection that whatever the Prophet has in terms of that right, also ulil azm, ulil amr also the same. So that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't put another lamb there, because it's connected to ulil azm, to ar-rasul, which is the previous word. Yes.
Yes. Ask about the T-shirt of the ulama is wearing.
I'm sorry?
You give the example of the Ayatollah wearing the T-shirt.
Yes.
When I heard that during the time of the Prophet and Imam, when somebody's come, they are unable to recognize who is the Imam. So when this traditional, the wearing of the ulama, that wearing the all abaya and cap, this is a traditional or there's a recommendation from the Imam?
No, this is from the Prophet. This tradition was started by the Prophet. But when the Imams, when they say they didn't recognize them, because sometimes people come to visit Imams and they are in the garden working. So Imam doesn't take turban to the garden.
right? Obviously, you have to wear the normal clothes to be in the garden. Or when Imam, like one hadith, when the Imam was in the garden working on Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. And Imam walked in there and he was asking, I wanted to see the grandson of the Prophet. They said, oh, he's there working. He went and said, no, I mean the grandson of the Prophet. I said, then he went to Imam and said, are you the grandson of? He said, yes, I am. He said, I saw you working. In Allah loves to see his servant who works and depend on themselves with their own hands. Right? So when imams go into those kind of situations, they don't wear those kind of regular clothes. So they take them out, so it's very hard for people to know them. Like Imam Ja'far Imam Zain al-Abidin, when at night he goes to give food, he doesn't wear his regular clothes. Because then people know, oh, he's Imam Zain al-Abidin. So he takes the amama off, and he wears the dishdash only, and then he goes and do those kind of things. So when you see Imam, he might not recognize them. This is in that kind of situation.
I guess, Sheikh, the question is, can I also wear what you are wearing?
The answer is yes. When you go to our maraja, right? When you go to Risala Amaliya, Sayyid Sistani, Sayyid Al Hakim, Sayyid Khamenei, and all of that, and their Risala Amaliya, there is a chapter called Bab Libas al Musalli, meaning the clothes of a person performing prayer. When you go there, when they describe it, they say it's mustahab to wear aba and kabab and amamah. So it's mustahab to wear them. But I know for sure that also it comes with responsibility, because when you put it, you're going to get some questions. If you are not ready, it might be a disaster sometimes. So it has to be like, if you want to put the army clothes, you have to better know how to shoot. Right? If you wear the clothes of army, you better know how to shoot a gun. If you're not anywhere and they give you a gun and something happened, then you have to blame yourself.
Yes. Question.
Yes.
So the understanding and the essence of the Islam, the definition and the understanding, the method of the word, how did it get so, you know, changed over the time, right? I mean, our Shia faith is so, such a fundamental essence of it, right?
Yes.
How did it get so diluted or completely corrupted over the years? I mean, how was it understood during the time of the Khulafa, the definition of Islam? How was it perceived by them?
Yes. Like we said, you know, historically speaking, you know, a lot of people who were around the Prophet, we have to understand, according to the Quran and Surah Al-Tawbah, a lot of people accepted Islam, they sat around the Prophet, but they really not believers. And Quran mentioned, in Surah Al-Tawbah, وَمِمَّنْ حَوْلَكَ مِنَ الْأَعْرَابِ مُنَافِقُونَ Ya Rasulallah, those who sit around you, they call themselves Muslim, Allah said, munafiqun, la ta'lamuhum. Some of them, you don't even know them, we know them. سَنُعَذِّبُهُمْ مَرَّتَيْنِ Allah said, we'll punish them twice. That is how worse the situation was. Some of them, the Quran tells us, this is the sign of munafiqun. But some of them, they are so sensitive that you cannot even talk. Now, those people around the Prophet, they are there as we believe in the Prophet, but certain things happen, they go up the roof. They say, you are not a prophet. How can you do this? How can this? I'll give you an example. In the Ghadir, right? The Prophet saying, Ya ayyuhar rasul, balligh. Unless, Ya ayyuhar rasul, the call comes from Allah, right? Balligh ma unzila ilaykum min rabbik. Wa in lam taf'al fama ballaghta risalatih. The most harsh language in the Quran Allah ever used to the Prophet. About you, it's the day of Ghadir. Right? After all of this, a man comes and says, "Al hada mink or min Allah? Is this from you or from Allah?" Okay, what are you? I just said, "Ya ayyuhar Rasul." I just told you, Allah sent it. Jabra'il said, "No. Is this from you?" Then the Prophet, even with all the patience, he tells him, "Min Allah. It's not from me. It's from you." And then he goes and said, "In kana min Allah, Allahumma anzil alayhi hijara. If this is truly from you, Ya Allah, send me a rock from the sky." Can you imagine? These are companions of the Prophet. He just came from Hajj. What the Prophet? He was behind the Prophet, doing tawaf, doing salah, doing sa'i, everything. But this is how he looks at the Prophet. This is kind of people. Or you have another companion. He goes with the Prophet. The Prophet does treaty, and he said, "Ma shakaktu fi nubuwwatika ka shakki laka fi yawmi." I used to doubt about whether you are a prophet or not. But what you did in Sulh al-Hudaybiyah confirm me that you are not a prophet. My doubt went all to the roof. These are people who consider prophets, you know, companions. Some of them were the earliest people to accept Islam. So in that case, some people were with the prophet, but they were not believers. So they're looking for every single chance to make the prophet even lower. So if the Isma will make him high, no, we have to think, no, he's not a masoom. If the Isma will make him high, then let's make him okay. He's masoom here and not here. Right? These are kind of things. So the Prophet, even though the Isma concept was there, Allah mentioned in all of this, but throughout the time, so some people can get the power, they have to put the Prophet down. So they can show their image high, or at least to the level of the Prophet.
Any last questions? Because it's almost about time.
We need some tips now.
Yes, please.
Questions. Oh, good job, Mom.
If Prophet Adam made disobeyed Allah, why is he still considered the Prophet?
Adam, the question of the brothers, if Adam disobey Allah, why do we consider him a prophet? The answer is, see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is Ghafurun and Rahim. Right? It's like our mother and our parents. How much we disobey them, but they still love us. Right? A mother, we disobey, you say bad things, right? But the love is still there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we disobey Him. As a people, I'm talking, as us, our level, we disobey Him on a daily basis. The moment we say, Ya Allah! And that's why Imam Ali said in dua, come in, Ya Sari'a. So fast to be pleased. I do a lot of bad things. The moment I say, Ya Allah, I say, Labbaik, come on, Imam. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not hold us because of one sin to kick us out. So that is one. And number two, Adam alayhi salam, what he did, as we mentioned, it was not a sin that deserved to take him out of his being prophet. Right? It was not what we call a dhanbul mutlaq. Dhanbul mutlaq means absolute sin. If that is what he have done, yes, that would have taken that right from him. But no, he did what we call tark bab al-awla, which is, he was not supposed to do that, even though it wasn't haram, and he did it, so that does not let him to lose his prophecy. Right. I'll give you an example. Like here in America, there are certain driving you do, you lose your license, right? Certain driving, you still get your license, you have to pay the fine. Right? The police catches and said, okay, your license is done, revoke. Which is, if the sin is like dhanbul mutlaq, you lose that holiness. But if the dhanb is no, it's something like tark bab al awla, you still have your right to drive. And you're not going to lose your license.
Any other questions? Yes, go ahead.
Yes, please.
Why this Surah Tawbah is the only Surah that does not start with Bismillah? Why?
Yes. The question is why Surah Tawbah does not start with Basmala? When you go to the Quran, every surah starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim except Tawbah. Now the answer our scholars gave was that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is about peace, aman. You know, rahmah of Allah is peace. Mercy of Allah is peace. But the surah Tawbah itself was revealed in declaration of war. Bara'atun min Allah. Wa Rasulihi, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet are denouncing. Right? So it's about war. So if you bring Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it doesn't make sense.
Ya Allah, here you're declaring war, and here you're saying peace. Now, which one is it? Because peace is opposite of war, and war is opposite of war? Of peace. So it doesn't add up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not start the surah with Bismillah, so that it made more sense that this surah is all about war. However, in the fiqh wise, this surah, when you start it, you are not allowed to read Surah Basmala. But if you start it in the middle, then you are allowed to start with Bismillah. Because the middle, some part of it, is not about war. In the beginning is what is about the war. So if you are starting from the beginning, then there is no Basmala. But if you started somewhere in the middle, then it's okay to start with Bismillah. However, also our scholars, they said, this Surah Tawbah has Bismillah too. And that Bismillah is replaced in Surah An-Naml, the chapter of Ant, where when Prophet Sulaiman was sending the letter to Bilqis, he stated, Innahu min Sulaiman wa innahu Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim that he wrote, they say that belongs to the Surah At-Tawbah, so that it makes the entire Quran is filled with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
Since we are talking about Bismillah, why is it an incomplete sentence in Arabic? It's not a complete sentence.
Which one? When you
Bismillah,
say
when we say Bismillah, it's not
a
complete sentence.
No, it is.
If I say
Aqra'u
Bismillah, then it becomes a complete sentence.
No, see, the word Bismillah is a complete sentence. It is shortened. Okay. You know, I'll tell you this. I really tell you this. Because the Arabic language is for lazy people. If you come from where I came from, and the way you, for example, I'll give you an example why I'm saying what I'm saying. You know, in Arabic, right? If you put a ya and the dhamma on it, right? What do you call it? You, right? You know, in the Arabic language, they say it's too harsh on our tongue. Right? Can you imagine? Just yeah, you put dhamma on ya, right? For example, you say qadi you, right? In the Lord, according to the Arabic, what we call ism al-fa'il, right? The actor in the sentence always have to finish with the dhamma. So you say, for example, dhahibu, right? Dharisu. Now you say, qadhi you. The Arabs, they say, no, ya with the dhamma is too tough on our tongue. So we don't want to say ya, dhamma on the ya. So what do you say? You say, qadhi. Now you come to Urdu, how many you do you have in there? How many you do you have in other languages? And you're fine with it, right? But for them, it's too heavy. Now, when you come to Bismillah, the actual sentence is Abtadi'u bi-ismillah. Meaning, I begin in the name of Allah. That's the full sentence, right? But they say, okay, Abtadi'u bi-ismillah is too much. So let's take Abtadi'u out. Instead of Abtadi'u, Bismillah. Right? Now, you come to the actual sentence is supposed to say, Bismillah. They say B-E is too much. So just drop the alif and make it bis. Now you see where I'm coming from? That is what I'm saying. So the actual is a full sentence, but it's because of the laziness, we have to cut some to make it shorter. Yes.
Allah.